Hallelujah. Let us study about the Passover lamb, the scapegoat, the sin sacrifice or sin offering, and the propitiation. All these represent Jesus Christ. We worship the Lord Jesus Christ as God. We study a lot of things about Jesus Christ and what he has done for us. However, most of us miss the identity, and so there's a possibility that we may be worshipping our own Jesus, who is another Jesus, false Christ and Antichrist according to the Bible. So, let us look at the Jesus Christ who saves us, and even from the Old Testament. In the beginning, Jesus Christ was God the Word. When Pharaoh repeatedly denied Israel to go free from slavery, God was about to kill all the firstborn in Egypt. God told Moses to let all the Israel families kill a lamb for them and put the blood of the lamb on the doorpost in the houses. If it was just a lamb, it does not matter much, but symbolically it was Jesus Christ himself. 1 Corinthians chapter 5 verse 7 says, "For even Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us." Even in the Old Testament, he has died for us as a Passover lamb. Further, this one thing we must notice very carefully. It is God who kills the firstborn, and it is the same God who put his life as the Passover lamb to save the life of the people, his people, that is Israel. Even though it is difficult for us to understand, please try to get this. Christians think that the devil punishes them and God saves them. It is not so. There's a lot of books written that devil is the master of hell and he punishes all the people. Jesus could not do anything, and he sympathized for them, but he could not help them. That's the way the books are written, and Christians believe that nonsense. It is God who will punish the unrighteous, and it is the same God even gives his life to save the righteous. It is the spiritual truth. The devil has no part in either the punishment in hell or the salvation that takes us to heaven. Both are done by the same God who is Jesus Christ. God the Word became a man, and he died on the cross for the sins of the world. Then he was raised from his death as the begotten Son and God in the omnipotent Spirit. As God, he removes or takes away our sins as the scapegoat would do and makes us sanctified. And as the author of salvation, he forgives our past sins, and by doing so, he perfects us. Let us study the true Jesus Christ, who is our Passover lamb, the scapegoat, the sacrificial lamb, and the propitiation. Well, let us study one by one, and the first one we'll study that Jesus Christ as our Passover lamb is who sacrificed for us. During the reign of the Pharaoh in Egypt, the Jewish peoples were slaves. God chose Moses to speak and to demand Pharaoh that he releases the Hebrews from slavery. Pharaoh repeatedly refused, and God brought plagues on the Egyptians. The final plague brought death to the firstborn in Egypt, in every Egyptian household. God told Moses that he would kill the firstborn in every house in Egypt, since Pharaoh did not let the people of Israel go free from slavery. God told Moses that the people of Israel must sacrifice a lamb in every household and strike the blood on the doorposts in the houses. Exodus chapter 12, verse 7 and 8. Verse 7, "And they shall take off the blood and strike it on the two side posts and on the upper doorpost of the houses, wherein they shall eat the Passover. Verse 8, And they shall eat the flesh in that night, roast with fire, and with unleavened bread, and with bitter herbs that they shall eat. So then the firstborn children would be spared in the Hebrew homes that were marked with the lamb's blood. Pharaoh's firstborn son was killed. Then Pharaoh released Hebrews from slavery. This is the origin of Passover. God declared that the future generations must keep a feast to remember this incident. Christians and Jews celebrate the Passover in different ways. Christians observe it as communion to remember the death of Jesus. Two elements are attached to this ritual. One is wine as a symbol of the blood of Jesus, and the next must be unleavened bread. But we buy bread from a bakery, mostly it may be leavened bread. But what to do? Most of us don't pay attention to that. The leaven in the bread represents sin in our lives. This represents sin in our lives. So that sin which is represented must be removed from us. That means it must be unleavened bread. So it represents us, and so sin must be removed from us as we participate in the communion. Jews do not know who the Lamb is. The Lamb is Jesus Christ. They have no knowledge of it. And Christians do not know anything about the leaven, which is sin, in the bread as a symbol, but in us as the reality. So the sacred function is celebrated just as a ceremony only, without understanding, but with no life application to that ceremony in our lives. 1 Corinthians chapter 5 verse 7 says, "Purge out therefore the old leaven, that you must be a new lump." See, it represents us as you are unleavened. For even Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. So it is a caution to Christians that Jesus was sacrificed as a Passover, and so purge out the sins in our lives to participate in the blood of Jesus Christ. Let us see what Jesus Christ says about this. It is in John chapter 6 verses 32 to verse 60. From 32 to 60, it's a long passage. It cannot be read here. It'll take too much time because of want of time. I'm not reading it now. I'm not reading the whole passage. Please read it at home to make a good understanding. Jesus Christ was teaching in this lesson in figure of speech. Jesus Christ offers them eternal life through the life in this simple ceremony. Not in the ceremony. The ceremony won't save nobody. But in the life after the ceremony. The life application of that ceremony. The life will be difficult because Jesus demands to purge our sins. But it'll give the inheritance in heaven. That's plenty. The inheritance in heaven, in his home, in the house of, or in the kingdom of God himself. John chapter 6 verses 53 to 56. Let me read that. John chapter 6. Verses 53 to 56. "Then Jesus said unto them, Verily, verily, I say unto you, except you eat the flesh of the Son of Man." See, he says the flesh of the Son of Man. But ceremonially we take the piece of bread. But in the spiritual reality, it's the flesh of Jesus Christ himself. "And drink his blood, that you have no life in you." That means we sip the sip of wine or grape juice, but that's a symbol But in reality, in practical, spiritual practical life, it must be the blood of Jesus Christ. The blood applies to us. Verse 54, whoso eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood hath eternal life. Eateth his flesh and drinketh his blood, that means he, his broken parts, his broken body, become a part of us. That means in practical life, we must be living as Jesus. That's the idea. And I will raise him up on the last day. That is, in resurrection, we will be raised to inherit the kingdom of heaven. And verse 55, but my flesh is meat indeed, my blood is drink indeed. He that eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood dwelleth in me, and I in him. So we will become part of him, because his blood and his bread in us, then we in him. That is how God, Jesus Christ, and we merge together, abide in each other. That is the key. Not only in ceremony. Here it's talking about symbolic language, and we take it as in a communion, as a ceremony, but not only in ceremony, but in life also. And then that will give us eternal life. And Christians take ceremonial communion, confess the blood by a statement. They say something to confess the blood, but they're not washed by it. And so that means the life is not clean. And they eat the bread, but never take Christ to abide in them, never bother about the leaven. So maybe they don't know, or even they know it, they ignore it, and so they take it as a ceremony and walk out of it, and nothing affects their life. And so never heard about the bitter herbs, and which is the cross of Jesus, the cross of us. We take our cross, that's what Jesus said, to mortify the deeds of the flesh. Jesus, that the Jews celebrate the Passover, and Christians take communion as a ceremony only. But the ceremony without life cannot give us eternal inheritance. If we put that in our life, practical living, then we'll inherit the kingdom of God, and we'll be part of the kingdom. We will be joiners with Jesus Christ. That's a great super jackpot. That's the idea. Then, he is a scapegoat who takes away our sins. In the Old Testament, God has established the priesthood and made a covenant with Israel. God told them to sacrifice animals for the forgiveness of ignorant sins and to send away a scapegoat for all other sins. One goat was to be killed for forgiveness of sins, and another goat is called the scapegoat to take away all other sins. That is, to remove all sins from them. Sin sacrifices are explained in Leviticus chapter 4 and chapter 5, and the scapegoat is in Leviticus chapter 16. So let me read verse 21 and 22. Leviticus again. Leviticus verse chapter 16, verse 21 and 22. And Aaron shall lay both his hands upon the hand the head of the live goat, and confess over him all the iniquities of the children of Israel, and all their transgressions in all their sin, of all their sins, putting them upon the head of the goat, and shall send. That means ceremonially he transfers all the sins of the people of Israel, complete, total, all the sins, on the goat. That means the goat bear all the sins, and send him away by the hand of a fit man into the wilderness. They send him to the wilderness. That means the boat, the goat, carry all the sins to the wilderness. Verse 22, And the goat shall bear upon him all their iniquities unto a land not inhabited, and he shall let go the goat in the wilderness. That means carried away the sins. Their scribes and Pharisees did not teach this principle to the people. The sins must be carried away. They were not taught. Neither our preachers teach this to us either. The communion, who teach this? Nobody teach this. And I have not heard the pastors teach the congregation. So, in the Old Testament, sins were repeated because they don't know it, maybe. Even if they know it, they may do it as something else. But they were not taught, and so they repeated. The sacrifices were continued. God the Father did not like the fact that sins were not removed. The purpose is the sins must be carried away, and the other sins were sacrificed. And so, that is, all the sins must be by the sacrifice and by the carrying away, it must be removed from them, but it was not removed. So God the Father was not sacrificed by that. Was not satisfied with the sacrifices, and the sacrifice was continued, and God intended not for the sacrifice to continue. At one point it should stop, but it did not stop. So God the Father sent God the Word to become a man to take away the first priesthood. He's not satisfied with the priesthood because they keep on sacrificing, but as well as the first covenant. The covenant of the sacrifice and takeaways, as symbolically, he don't want that anymore. He want to remove that and to establish the second priesthood. In the priesthood, Jesus himself is a high priest under the order, in the order of Melchizedek, and that's the one. So that means all the priesthood, all the pastor, those kind of church celebration, those kind of things. Before there was temple, now it's a church thing. So it is continuing, but God's intention is to remove all those, and we have Jesus, and so we all, congregation, must come to Jesus to worship him, and he is the high priest, he's our high priest in the order of Melchizedek. So God the Word became a man, who was Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus has established the second priesthood and the second covenant. He has done his part. It is to remove the sins of the people as their scapegoat and then to forgive their past sins. Those two, Jesus, spiritually, with that's called spiritual practicality. He will do that. And that's what the purpose is, to change the first covenant and first order and establish the second order. Forgive sins and take away sins are two entirely different things. John the Baptist, when you see Jesus, and that's in John chapter 1 verse 29, says, "Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sins of the people." We all connected to the cross. He died for that. That's for forgiveness. That's not for taking away. John the Baptist was prophesying even that this man will be resurrected and come back, and then as the resurrected Lord Jesus Christ is in the Spirit, and he will take away the sins of the people. That is supernaturally done, spiritually done. That's what John the Baptist was prophesying. He takes away the sins and remove the sins, remove the sin nature from the people. The unrighteousness in them, he'll take it away, so that they may not sin again. That is the idea. Acts chapter 3 verse 26 says, "Unto you first God," that is God the Father, "having raised up his son Jesus, send him to bless you in turning away every one of you from his iniquities." He removed the iniquities. It is not forgiveness. It's a different thing. He forgives also, but this is another action, another work of him. This is the work to remove the sins from us, and the resurrected Jesus Christ, he will do the turning away because he's God. But we cannot see him by our eyes. He is spiritual but omnipotent God. And Jesus, he removes the unrighteousness which causes sin from the people. Please notice that this is the same function of the scapegoat in the Old Testament. And it's not forgiveness. The scapegoat takes away the sin that removes sin nature from people. But what happened was, it was done ceremonially, but not in their practical life. It stopped with the ceremony only, not applied to the life. If you like to have a few additional points in the scapegoat and to know about the detail of the things, and I will have a couple of links in the transcript page, and you can look at it and to study in detail. Now, Jesus gave himself as a sin sacrifice, and his blood will be applied for only one time to forgive. So this everybody know that Jesus died on the cross to forgive us, forgive our sins. That is the sacrifice. That's one part. Sacrifice to forgive. This one lamb was sacrificed. Another lamb was taken away. That's the scapegoat. So he did two parts. Resurrected Jesus Christ is the scapegoat, and the man Jesus was a sacrifice. So let's read Leviticus chapter 4. Leviticus chapter 4, verses 1 to 4. Leviticus chapter 4. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, Speak unto the children of Israel, saying, If a soul shall sin through ignorance against any of the commandments of the Lord concerning things which ought not to be done, that means if they disobey the things which they are not supposed to do, and shall do against them, if the priest, and then it comes to the priest, that's one of the people, and verse 3 is against the people, against the priest. If the priest that is anointed do sin according to the sin of the people, so this similar to the people, and they also sin. If they do that, let him bring it for his sin, and which he has sinned, bullock, with a young bullock without blemish unto the Lord for a sin offering. As again, the priest or the people, doesn't matter whoever sinned, then they had to bring the sin offering or sin sacrifice. Verse 4, he shall bring the bullock unto the door of the tabernacle and the congregation before the Lord. They all gather there and shall lay his hand upon the bullock's head and kill the bullock. So bullock is sacrificed before the Lord. Then the entire chapter, verse 4, the 4 and chapter 5, explains the details of it. If you like to study or curious to find out the details, you can study the chapter 4 and 5. When these sacrifices and offerings are done, when the sacrifices will go through all the procedures and done, all the sins for which the sacrifices and offerings are made will be forgiven simultaneously. That's what is taught, and that's what God has done. It's forgiven them. In the New Testament, people cannot sacrifice. People are not allowed to sacrifice. People do not sacrifice. That system is removed. So Jesus Christ has removed the first system and established the second system by sacrificing himself. He put himself on the cross. He died himself for the sins of the whole world, not for a few people. So that first system is entirely removed, and the system, second system is established. 1 Corinthians chapter 5 verse 3 says, Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. So scripture says that first will be removed, the second will be established. He died for our sins. There's no more sacrifices that you do. You cannot do any sacrifice. So in the second system, Jesus has done the sacrifice, and the sins of the people cannot be forgiven as before. Before, it was simultaneously forgiven. Forget it. That's gone. So the sins of the people will not be removed just because Jesus Christ was sacrificed. He sacrificed himself. You did not put the animal. You did not do anything. So it will not apply to you simultaneously. But now, if we ask God to forgive sins without the sacrifice, we ask God, please forgive me. And God may forgive that sin, but the blood of Jesus Christ will not be applied at that point. God will forgive you, because if you commit sin and you are sick because of that, God forgive that sin so that you may be healed. or some other calamity came to you and you were not to have relief from that, and you ask forgiveness, God may forgive you, just to give relief from that calamity. Those kind of things God does, God forgives if you ask forgiveness. But that will not be by His blood. His blood will be applied only one time. That is the one who will take you to eternal life. So the other forgiveness will maybe give you healing and maybe give you relief and give you comfort and all these kind of things. But that will not apply to eternal life. Since the offering of Jesus Christ was made only one time, and forgiveness by the blood will also be done as the grand finale, and it will not happen often, it will be happen only one time. Pastors will not teach that. I don't know why they don't teach that. And the preachers will not preach that. It is the truth of the Bible. That's the way God will act. God go by the word of God. What He promised in the word of God, He will do. He will not do what you wish or what the pastors wish. What you say mean nothing to God. God will go by what He says. This is the only forgiveness that will be counted for eternal life. If people are forgiven otherwise, it may be for different reasons, such as healings, etc. 1 John chapter 7, chapter 1. 1 John chapter 1. First John chapter 1 verses 7 and 9. But if we walk in the light as He is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, His Son, cleanseth us from all sins. If we walk as Jesus Christ walk, the apostles will have fellowship with the believers. Apostles have fellowship with God the Father and Jesus Christ. So they will have the same fellowship with them. So through the apostles, and then even the people will have fellowship with them when we walk in the light as Jesus Christ is the light. That's verse 7 says. Verse 9 says, if we confess our sins, that He is faithful and just to forgive. We tell them. Sometimes we do ceremonially. It's not ceremonially. We put forth our sins to Him. Pour it to His feet. That's in practical life we do. That means then we will not do the sins anymore. Pour it out and forgive just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. The unrighteousness, because of our unrighteousness, we are committing sin. Because we are evil, we are bad, we have unrighteousness, we are not righteous. That is the reason. That's the addiction, or the core of your being is causing us to commit sin. So He takes that core of unrighteousness from us and He cleanses. He, as a scapegoat, He takes it away, pulls it away, and with the blood, and He cleanses, washes it out. That means you are not a sinning person anymore. He will make you clean. It is supernaturally done, and it's explained in here. If you are spiritual, if you have the Holy Spirit in you, you will understand it. Intellectually, you cannot understand it. Forget it. You cannot understand it intellectually. You must understand it spiritually. He will cleanse you pure, complete. You will be perfect. So it is the doing of God. God will do this. To clear all the forgiveness, all the unrighteousness, which is the very core of the root cause of sinning nature. And after that, you will not commit sin, because the nature to commit sin is removed and cleansed away by His blood. And as a scapegoat, He removes it. Both actions combined will take it away. So, the people, who is that? If it's you or if it's somebody else, and they will not commit sin after that. Those people are now saved. Now in Christianity, everybody said, as soon as you tell the name of Jesus, Jesus, hallelujah, you forgive me, that's it. Then you are saved. They pronounce, now you are saved, they say. Baloney. They don't even know what saved means. This is what is saved. They are saved from their sins, as in Matthew chapter 1, verse 21. It says, thou shalt call him Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. So salvation is from sin. Even though Jesus Christ died for our, the people in the whole world are not saved. And you are cleansed from all sins of righteousness. Those are the people, his people. They are the only one who is saved. If you like to study the details, and I'll give some links in the transcript page that you can study it in detail. Then, Jesus is the propitiation. Propitiation is a sacrifice that is applied after grace has completed the work. The same thing, this is the kind of revision we put all together. God says they're called as propitiation, the sacrificial lamb, and the same way the scapegoat and all these things, God put it together as one, and he gives it to you, and he calls it a propitiation. This is one pack that we studied before. It's in one pack that's called propitiation. 1 John chapter 2, verse 2 here, verse 2. And he is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. So, Jesus Christ is the propitiation for the sins of the entire world, but only his people will be saved. He's a propitiation because Jesus did all these things for the entire world. He died for the entire world, but he will not carry away the sins of the entire world. Who were open to him, who were called for him, who were looking for him. Those are the people. The second scapegoat will come to those people only. Scapegoat is the resurrected Lord Jesus Christ. The true resurrected Lord Jesus, not the elevated, not the other Jesus Christ. The man Jesus Christ, the kind of, the picture of the man Jesus Christ, they elevated to and called that as a legend. Legend is not God. Legend is man-made God. They visualize something. That's called legend. The man Jesus, they make God out of them. No, the true Jesus Christ is resurrected. He's made God. He's the begotten Son. He is God. He comes and he do the scapegoat work. He will not go to the whole world, not to everybody. If you're looking for him, only you will see him. You will recognize him. You will know him. You will receive him, and he will do the scapegoat work on you, on those people only, not everybody. But he died for the whole world, and he can forgive anybody. That's what he said, I am for the whole world, but if you willing to come to me, I will clean you perfect. That is the work. Two works, one is for the whole world, and the next one is if you look for him, for you only. So that is the two works of Jesus Christ. This is called propitiation. It's called two-part. It's work in sequence. The first part we may also call grace. Grace will work first and will complete its work of redemption. It's called redemption. And then Jesus Christ will forgive all our past sins by his blood. Work of grace is a redemption done, redemption work done as the scapegoat, and it will remove all the iniquities and sins. When that is done by Jesus Christ, then as the author of salvation, he will forgive. So that's the one, forgive one time. See, the first one will remove, make you, will redeem you, and then the sanctify you, everything is done. Then and then only the blood will be applied one time, make you perfect, and you will inherit eternal life. That's the time you are saved and your heaven is guaranteed. It's not that you may not, but 99% guaranteed for these people. Not everybody who call Jesus and call themselves saved. That's a fake. That's not true. That's not reality. Romans chapter 3 verse 24 says, being justified freely by his grace, that's the first word, through the redemption that is in Jesus Christ. That is, we call him grace will redeem the person first. When that is done, verse 25 says, whom God has set forth to be propitiation through faith in his blood, to declare his righteousness by the remission of sins that are past. Because past sins we were committed, the new sins we will not do, that's all clean. But the past sins we already committed is on your head. So that was hanging on you. God forgives those things at one time, so all gone. So the past things, whatever you have done, the sins and iniquities, will be gone, complete. So all sins are clean, slate clean. And so after being justified by grace, as verse 24 and verse 25 says, that God was forbearing all this time, forgetting and patiently waiting for the grace work to be completed. And when that's done, and not through his righteousness, God forgive all your past sins. So, by propitiation, we are completely saved. 1 John chapter 4, verses 9 and 10. 1 John 4, verses 9 and 10. In this was manifested the love of God towards us, because that God sent his only begotten Son into the world. Begotten Son is the resurrected Lord Jesus Christ, not the man Jesus. He's a begotten, and he's God, he's made God, that we might live through him. So he's in spirit, we can live through him. That means we are in him, we abide in him. Verse 10, herein the love, not that we loved God, but God loved us and sent his Son to be propitiation for our sins. This was a propitiation. So when that is done, so both together will save us. Here, verse 9, says the begotten Son, the resurrected Jesus Christ, will come remove all the sins as the sacrifice. He forgives all the sins. And Hebrews chapter 9, verse 28 says, so Christ was once offered to bear the sins of men. That was the man Jesus. He was offered as a sacrifice. And to them that look for him shall he appear the second time without sins unto salvation. That's where salvation comes in. People take the scripture without knowing. They refer to the second coming for the destruction of the world and those kind of things. That's nonsense. This is what he says. The resurrected Lord Jesus will come to you to give you salvation now. If you are not saved now, after death there will be judgment. There is no salvation after death. Believe me, scripture says after death is a judgment, not salvation. Salvation is now. If you are saved now, you are saved. This is the salvation now. First portion of the verse referred to the offering as a sin offering. And the second portion as the author, second portion refer to the resurrected Lord Jesus Christ, and he says he will appear personally if you're looking for him to you. Salvation is personal, not to the whole world. He will remove and salvation that will give you inheritance in his kingdom, in heaven where God is. Look for the true Jesus Christ, who is here, and he is omnipotent spirit, and he is God. For the last 2,000 plus years he is here, and he will give us salvation, which is the inheritance in the kingdom of heaven. He is waiting for you if you are looking for him. Thank you for listening. May God bless you and be with you. Amen.